Welcome to today's webinar. We are going to be covering a few different topics predominantly. So we're going to be looking at why use AR for retail, what opportunities do we feel are ripe in retail right now, how you can leverage AR in the retail customer journey, and also my personal favorite, how AR will be increasingly used in the future. So without further ado, I'm going to hand you over to Casper, Martin and Ed for the fun part. Over to you guys.
Brilliant, thanks Grace. I just noticed looking at this slide how pale I look in comparison to Martin and Ed. In fact, as you go from left to right, it's like a colour chart. I think I desperate need of a holiday. Thank you everyone. I'm delighted as one of the CEO Zappa to be joined by Martin, our sales director, and Ed, our VP of Strategic Partnerships, who heads up our business over in North America. And indeed, two of the gentlemen in our organization who have the greatest experience of sort of dealing frontline with how to use AR in retail. So delighted to be joined by them. I thought, Grace, if you wouldn't mind moving on a slide, just for those of you who may not know who Zappa are, I'll give you the very quick rundown on that. So effectively, Zappa is a privately owned creative consultancy and technology business rolled into one. We've got 65 people located primarily at our headquarters in London, where Grace was just seen. But also, we have a wholly owned subsidiary in the US where Ed is based. And there are three killer pillars to our business that make us unique. And they are all built around really the central mission of democratizing AR and really delivering value through camera strategies to our partners and our end users. And so that is really about being the most sort of valued partners for brands and businesses, agencies and developers to deliver AR in a way that is robust and scalable and affordable and effective, you know, for whatever their needs. And so we have these three aspects of our business. We have Zappa, designers, developers, QA strategists on that. In the middle, we have Zapworks, our content authoring and publishing platform and really tools. And finally, we have Zapbox, which is our hardware product and will be the world's most affordable 6DoF XR headset in the market come the end of this year, which is very exciting. And over the past 10 years, we've had then the great privilege of working with thought leading brands from across the world in bringing their camera strategies to life. If you move on to the next slide, then Grace. And I guess before, you know, we've previously covered retail a number of times as a subject area, as it is really a key vertical for us. And indeed, we've worked with a lot over the years, spanning the whole world from Walmart to Asda and Tesco's and Carrefour and Ocean and Bedronka in Europe to Toys R Us when they were still going, Woolworths, Countdown, 7-Eleven, Tilly's, the list goes on really. And out of this has come what we call our tip method, you know, how we elicit taps, trips and transactions through the work that we do and our five C's for success in AR. But as Grace said at the start, today we're really going to take a closer look at a number of recent case studies we worked on to give a snapshot of the state of play at the moment, as well as tentatively look forward as to what's on the horizon for retail and spatial computing. And why are we doing that? And why is that important? So if you move forward one, Grace. The reason for that is that clearly our mobile devices are increasingly bridging the gap between physical and digital retail, both in store and online. And the camera has become an additional lens for product visualization, so to elicit information, inspiration and incentivization. And all the data, and there's more showing up all the time, would say that this stuff works. You know, it helps decision making, it increases attention and engagement and memory recall. It reduces bounce rates and heightens conversion to sale. And that's coming from a plethora of different sources. So let's get into the weeds of this really and explore this in more detail. So we have a number of case studies, and Grace, if you go on to the next slide, five in total for King's Hawaiian and Countdown and Motorola, Xfinity and indeed 7-Eleven. And we're gonna go through those and Martin and Ed are gonna talk to those. So, Ed, perhaps you'd like to kick us off with King's Hawaiian and that recent omnichannel shopper marketing campaign in the US.
Absolutely. Thanks, Casper. And hello, everyone. So yeah, this past summer, and yes, sad to say, it does appear that summer is over. We did a really exciting campaign with King's Hawaiian, the bakery company. They paired up with Guy Fieri really to promote a lot of their summer SKUs, so predominantly their hot dog buns and sliders. King's Hawaiian is quite a unique product actually, because they live kind of in two places depending on what the grocery store or retail is. They sometimes are in the deli, they're sometimes in the bakery. And the brand very much sees this as both a pro and a con. So very much what we were trying to do was create an experience that drew you to the product within whatever the store framework was. And when you got there, just gave you a raft of these amazing experiences. So a bunch of different games, which you can see on screen, some photo features, recipe guides, all of this was kind of tied in with the larger than life character to Guy Fieri as well. What we did over the top of this is we layered in a sweeps component. You can see on screen this concept of flavor points, which we developed, different actions that were performed both in retail environments and then back at home, and different points values. These could be exchanged for different merch and then entries into the grand prize, which was a trip to Hawaii. So again, this was, we delivered this very much in a web AR framework. So we had a lot of conversations about whether to do this in an app, generally down to the complexity of the build, but we opted to do this in the web, and we're really, really happy with how it performed. Retail, there were definitely some learnings from that. Potentially the complexity of the experience was something to do there. But where we really saw really, really exceptional engagement was at home. There was a really fantastic omni-channel push for this campaign. And we saw some really good results from that as well, which I hope to be able to share soon. But the campaign has literally just finished. Can we go on to the next one, please, Grace? And I think over to you, Martin, for this.
Thanks, Ed. And that's, I think that omni-channel approach of activating this at retail and at home is something that's also borne out by this next case study, for which we travel all the way to New Zealand. And actually this campaign is ranks up there with one of my favorites, because it combines amazing content with also knockout results. And the client here was Countdown, and they're one of New Zealand's leading supermarket chains. And the overall campaign, their objective was to drive frequency of visits into store, as well as average basket spend. And they wanted to do this in a way that was fun for the kids, because they were targeting a family audience, but also came with approval from the parents because of this sort of underlying educational value. So the Super Insects campaign was a 6-week in-store loyalty, well, in-store and online loyalty program that rewarded the consumers for spending over $30 on their shop with a flow pack of these insect fact cards, which taught the consumer about the indigenous species and enabled the kids to play a kind of Top Trump style game with the physical cards themselves. Now, our partners Craze were responsible for the creation of all of those physical cards and additional merch that was sold in store. And Zappa's role in the campaign was to add a digital layer of content to these physical cards. So as Casper mentioned earlier, you know, bridging that physical and digital divide. And the digital layer was critically important in order to make the cards more collectible and deepen the consumer engagement in the overall campaign. So we created the Super Insects app, and this was a key part in the campaign and acted like a home and a hub for the experiences on the user's device throughout the length of the campaign. And through this app, as you can see on the video, the user can scan certain power cards to unlock digital animations of the insects, like the, we've got, I can't really tell you what bug that is, but the ladybird or the butterfly, and then bring those to life off the power cards. They could take part in a fun insect quiz and compete against their siblings or their friends. They can learn about habitats of the insects through exploring a world tract forest, as you can see appearing on the screen here. And they'd have to walk around and actually find the insects themselves. And then they can play fun games and take face filters as a reward for taking part and participating in the whole experience. But what I was really blown away by, and so were Countdown, were the stats that this delivered. And when you're looking at these stats, please bear in mind that the total population of New Zealand is under 5 million. So there were over 1.4 million visits to the app homepage. There were 3.1 million scans of the trading cards. The face filters were viewed nearly 730,000 times. The quiz was played 407,000 times. And the app itself was rated number one in the New Zealand education store. And from the retailer's point of view, they did share that transactions over $30 grew by 5% year on year. And if you think about that total population size of just 5 million, that it kind of roughly equates to just over 1% of the New Zealand population downloaded the Super Insects app. So interestingly enough, we did have the conversation during the wash-up with the app team, who were responsible for marketing the Countdown's own retail app. And they were astounded at how quickly Super Insects managed to gather that many users in such a short space of time. And as we looked at the analysis, we saw a really long tail that while the campaign only lasted 6 weeks in store, we're still now, you know, knocking on a year later, we are still getting thousands upon thousands of people playing the app from a campaign that's almost a year old. Grace, if we move on to the next screen, I just want to touch on a point that Casper very quickly flashed up onto the screen with the five C's. And one of the critical points about any campaign is as much to do with the successful digital development of the experience as it is around the communications and how we tell people within our customer group that the campaign exists, that AR content is there, how to get it and why they should care. And this is what we call the call to action or the communications. And Countdown really understood the whole importance and the critical nature of those comms and incorporated it throughout their marketing planning. And they promoted the campaign as well as the app download and the content through their store with physical signage. They promoted it online through the website as well as through their CRM channels. They promoted it on their social media platforms as well as through their influencers and gave it some support on TV and radio. And I won't dwell too long on this, but I would encourage anybody who's thinking of planning their own AR experience, whether this is in retail or any other vertical, is to put comms and the call to action really high on your agenda and think about it early on in the process, because it is such a critical mechanic to making sure it's a success. And I think this was borne out in the King's Hawaiian, as well as some of the other case studies that are about to be shared with you. So that concludes the brief introduction to Countdown, and I'll hand over back to Ed.
Thanks, Martin. Yeah, so I just wanted to run through this Motorola example because it was a really interesting use case. Initially, Motorola came to us actually through their L&D team to talk about creating an experience which showed off the key selling points and the main features of several of their devices, but did so in an interactive way. And the goal of this was to train sales reps. So during COVID, visits to the store were obviously down. So this was an opportunity to really kind of get the reps excited about the new handsets that were being released over a period of time. And show that. I think what was the most exciting for me about this one was very quickly the exact same experience that we built to train sales reps went straight to a consumer facing setting, and it was actually used in store as well. So this was a fantastic example of I guess really getting incremental value and bang for the buck to do that. So we were really, really excited with this, and it actually became a formula that we replicated for several of the devices that came out during COVID. I'm saying it like COVID's over, which unfortunately it isn't, but you know what I mean. Next slide, please, Grace. Thank you. So what I wanted to talk about here was so virtual product visualization and try-on. So on the right, you see kind of examples that we've used our face tracking technology. The video that's playing is a really exciting partnership that we've just entered into with a company called iBuy. Now, iBuy are leaders in the shoppable media space. And we really started speaking with them with the goal to bring shoppable AR. So almost kind of create this as a new opportunity that exists. Most notably, and the most significant thing with this is typically when you're in an AR experience, we've all seen kind of the neuroscience and neuromarketing behind it, whereby you are primed with an emotive response. You can prime a consumer to really kind of feel, pay more attention, feel emotive responses to the content that you're producing. But very often what happens is if the next step in that is a purchase, you're linking out from the AR experience to an e-commerce platform to complete that checkout process. What we've done with the partnership with iBuy is we've brought that checkout process into the AR experience. So you can complete that purchase without ever having to leave the AR experience. This is a brand new partnership. We're really, really excited about it and having several conversations at the moment with big brands, but this is very much, for anyone who may be interested in on the call, very much kind of a first to market opportunity. And we're really excited about the potential that this could bring across many brands and clients that we work with. Sorry, next slide, Grace, thanks. Just wanted to touch quickly on this one with it. We worked with Xfinity, Elephant and The Mill on this one. Casper Martin, feel free to jump in as well with your own thoughts, but really the concept here was about creating digital real estate in store. And most interestingly, this opportunity that a virtual store space can be limitless. So very much the physical confines of a traditional brick and mortar retail store, with augmented reality, there's huge, huge opportunities to kind of to extend that, to bring in different opportunities. I mean, there's really exciting things. I mean, we're coming into the holiday season as well. Think about kind of not having to deck out, physically fit out a brick and mortar store, bringing in a holiday theme through AR. Really, really kind of exciting opportunities here. And I don't know if Casper or Martin, you wanted to add a bit to that as well.
Yeah. I was going to say a few things on that one. I mean, there's two elements. One, you talk about kind of coming up to the holiday period. We know, you know, how much different sectors are suffering because of supply chain issues. And indeed, actually trying to get this new sort of any of that retail infrastructure in place is a challenge, and actually AR potentially delivers an opportunity there. But I think the other one is that sort of sense of actually, you know, your footprint is limitless. You know, the fact that you can turn any of those physical touch points into any sort of area is really quite interesting. But I think it also speaks to kind of how AR can play a role in permanence in retail, because I think one of the things that is coming more to the fore is almost trying to get a little bit out of the mindset of singular campaign planning or one-off promotions, and actually how do you create these appointment to visit experiences in store and these areas that do have these digital overlays that happen over a period of time. Because I think the thing that is certainly true about AR is once you've invested in that behavior change with your audience, how do you make sure that you actually make good on that and amortize that cost over time? And actually you've created an expectation to a degree that, you know, something wonderful and magical is going to happen. And how do you continue to surprise and delight people and offer them, you know, more information, greater sort of inspiring kind of decision-making opportunities and incentivization. So I think this idea of rethinking what that digital real estate can do for you in that setting is super interesting.
Yeah, and the resultant economies of scale as well. So I know we've had many of these conversations internally and with partners as well. AR can have an expensive one-off cost, but if you're creating a framework such as that you just described, that really, not to belittle it, but it can almost become more of an asset swap. So you build out the general framework and then you're rolling out these campaigns that align with key product deliveries or key seasons to really kind of, as you say, amortize that cost over time.
Yeah. Great, thanks, Ed. And I'll just chip in with a thought as well, because you mentioned earlier the almost like the endless catalog or the endless counter of products in there. And we're working with one of our coffee partners who, they sell lots of high-end coffee machines, and in probably a small percentage of their retail scenarios, they have their own boutique or they have staffed concessions within big department stores that can help people through that decision-making journey as they're trying to sort of pick their way through this bewildering number of different machines. But in a large majority of stores, there is nobody there. So they're just faced with a whole row of shiny coffee machines and no idea which one to buy. They're using the power of AR to really help the consumer through that decision-making process and make sure that they understand the range, understand what is right for them, and get them to a confident point of making a decision much quicker than potentially just guessing it or having to Google it on the spot and rolling the dice there. So I think the opportunity is great. It's being able to show the range of products that some physically aren't in store, but also to help people make that decision-making purchase. And Ed, to your point of scaling this, this is exactly what they have done. It is created in a way that can span different markets. It is a really good utility tool that's made with delightful content, but can be scaled across different markets and languages, and keep up with product launches. Mm. So there's definitely a lot of scope there to be delightful as well as useful.
Yeah, I think the big watch out always on this one is that those store staff have been made very aware that this digital superpower is coming to their store. And they know how to use it and how to leverage it. Because the one thing we know is that, you know, AR is a wonderful thing to show people, and it's a great conversation starter, and indeed, you know, all those other benefits. But it does rely on it being properly placed in store, you know, people checking it, and it's that human factor that I think is so important to make sure you get right, you know.
Yes, and I put that firmly in the comms bracket. That, yeah, as mentioned for the countdown, they thought about all of those elements really early on in the process. So it wasn't a shock at the 11th hour. Yeah. Cool, back to you, Ed.
Thanks, guys. Grace, if we can go to the next slide, I think, Casper, over to you for this.
7-Eleven, yeah, well, I mean, gosh, we've talked about 7-Eleven a great deal in the past, and you know, there's a reason for it. You know, they have been massively ahead of the industry in their adoption of really thinking about a camera strategy as an always-on approach to AR. You know, they've been doing this for the past 4 years now, and connecting AR to both brand promotional kind of marketing tentpole and seasonal activations through AR in order to deliver kind of valuable and instantly redeemable reward points to their customers, both in store and whilst on the go. And I think that is incredibly compelling. You know, when you are sort of bringing sort of an intangible digital value to real world tangible value, then you know you've got something really quite magical there. And I guess at the heart of all these reward schemes and collectibles is the very, very simple truth that rewards customers do spend more money than other customers. And you know, we see their activity, this activity through AR helps drive those sort of taps, trips, and transactions and that tip method we talked about earlier. And so this was, you know, a 365, 24/7 strategy that stood around these things, and that sort of most recent skateboard promotion has been no different. You know, actually that one has clocked up hundreds of thousands of users and gameplay and average dwell times of over 2 minutes and 30 seconds on average for these things. And so clearly what's critical here, and I can see in the chat there's been some sort of questions about, you know, which ones are native apps, which ones web AR. You know, this very much was a sort of an SDK integration into the Seven Rewards app, and importantly tying to those loyalty IDs of those individuals, so that then the reward redemptions and everything can be done sort of seamlessly and instantly, but making that available to brand partners to participate in different ways. It all just comes down to the value exchange and making sure that the types of experience fit the types of occasion, and clearly with 7-Eleven, some of that is when people are in store and entice them in store, others clearly, you know, when they're out of store and on the go. If you get it right, and it is about the right sort of interactions and the right level of reward redemption, then you can get a huge amount of repeatability and see that sort of cascading through into sales. If you move on to the next slide, Grace, one of the things that I guess, you know, off the back of a lot of the work with 7-Eleven and also seeing what else is beginning to emerge in retail, we sort of got into this sort of interesting space of looking at what the next level of, I guess, personalization and digital twinning and the age of avatars can kind of bring. There's an awful lot of talk of metaverses and that sort of for a separate session. But I think there is something fascinating about how, you know, avatars have become another sort of persona that we all buy into and a sort of gone beyond just gaming culture and seeping into sort of more general culture. I mean, I used to be involved in a business called VMe, stood for Make Me Virtual, and we were working with PlayStation Home back in 2007, 2008, 2009 it was. And at the time, you know, I guess this was when avatars were becoming much more prevalent in the way that user interfaces worked in console gaming. And, you know, we spun up a business and it still amazes me now around selling, you know, virtual coffees and virtual running machines and virtual items to people. And, you know, the first thing anyone does in PlayStation Home is, you know, they buy a dance pack and stand around and dance with each other and chat and wear things. You know, this is over 10 years ago, and it's amazing how, you know, that has just come on leaps and bounds in terms of obviously how that's gone further into, you know, obviously gaming with Fortnite and Roblox and the rest. But seeing how that has been adopted by brands and that sort of interplay between sort of certainly fashion culture and gaming culture and now into social media is something that is worth keeping an eye on. You know, when you see the likes of Gucci doing sort of virtual drops of items and participating in these things, and Louis Vuitton, etc., you know, they're just paving the way in many respects for others. And so there's something quite interesting about this notion of creating this virtual manifestation of yourself. And in a retail rewards, you know, customer sign up setting, you know, why not pair that loyalty ID with, you know, a customizable avatar that either can look like you or look nothing like you. Because hey, it's your choice, and it really does then allow for a different type of kind of opportunity for brand partners through then that relationship between sort of intangible reward and tangible reward in terms of virtual merchandise and the types of sponsoring that can go on there, and you get to play with then different types of commercial model in terms of how that works. It's obviously come out of fashion and retail and sort of streetwear with virtual drops and capsule collections and collabs with different types of partners. And indeed, then bringing that avatar, that persona into the camera view, and leveraging that in terms of other social sharing and how people respond to each other becomes really quite fascinating. So there's something, you know, obviously quite interesting going on here, and that sort of blending of virtual and real world reward systems for purchase and customer loyalty, and then allowing that avatar to exist at the center of that kind of ongoing value exchange and where that might take people. So we think that's really interesting, and it has kind of led us to do a, I might actually take the screen here if I can, Grace. This may go horribly wrong, but let's see if I can do this. I was going to show, it says I can't start screen share while the other participant is sharing.
Hang on, let me see if I stop sharing and then you can start, Casper. Apologies.
Let's see.
Probably admin should have been. Here we go.
Here we go. I can do that. Yeah, I mean, let's see. Hopefully everyone can see this. I think I actually saw Andre appear in the chat. This is Andre, our executive creative director. I mean, so this is quite a sort of skunk worksy thing that we're just looking at in the background, but this sort of notion of avatars are interesting, you know, personalization, interesting. You know, is there something where these two pieces come together? So this is, you know, very incomplete, just something we're exploring. But here you can see Andre actually in WebAR, he positions his face in the circle, handsome chap that he is. There is a sort of processing image step here, which I'm actually going to fast forward because it'll take a little bit of time, which we're kind of working on. But the interesting thing is at the end of this sequence, what that then produces is a digital twin, if you like, a version of Andre that has managed to take his glasses off. So that's a really interesting thing that we can kind of allow for. In this one, we've removed his hair. He's got a lovely head of hair, has Andre. But, you know, this also means that if we wanted to add wigs or caps or other things, you know, something that we have kind of taken out in this particular example. But it's, you know, from that single camera pose, you know, we're able to extract this image, create this likeness, and you know, then stitch that onto an animated body of Andre, and then take that to be his digital persona, and see how we then take that character into other activations that then Andre inhabits within that sort of branded world. So, you know, some work to do, but you know, I think even the early exploration of this is really quite fascinating as to where that might go. I'll screen back to you, Grace. I think there's it's the start of something, obviously. You know, we're hearing so much more about the idea of metaverses and use of avatars, but how that plays into sort of loyalty, retail, rewards, personalization, I think is something we'll see appear more and more. Next slide. Yoel, I believe that sort of kind of concludes the areas that we were kind of wanting to explore and sort of talk about. So it's really over to the floor. I don't know exactly what kind of, should check the chat really as to what questions have come through.
There was quite a an interesting chat on the chat around, you know, the app versus web AR and which one's best for retail.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think that's quite a deep question because it really depends on user environment, what they need, but wondered whether you had any thoughts on that.
I mean, I think it's there are a lot of people who want to talk just that where they are is the only way. And I think, you know, for many, it makes an awful lot of sense, especially I think if you're a CPG brand, that really, you know, you have to ask yourself, can you command the digital real estate on someone's screen to have a standalone app versus the other apps that they, you know, tend to use? And obviously WebAR makes, therefore, because of the lack of friction, you don't have to download an app, don't have to service that app, 365 makes a lot of sense. But I think, you know, if you are, you know, an app like 7-Elevens, and where you're offering an awful lot of different type of value as a kind of part of a loyalty customer scheme, and where, you know, you can take advantage of a lot of the things that you can do so well and performantly in a native app, then adding a camera function and a lens to that and a different way to engage your audience makes loads of sense as well. I mean, it's true, and, you know, we talk about sports marketing and the types of kind of fan engagement apps that go on there, because there's so many other things it does, of ticketing and what happens when you're actually at the stadium and all that sort of other pieces. So I think it's more a question of, again, not asking the question of I'd like to do something in AR, but going, what is our digital strategy and what role does the camera play in that? What's right? And I'd also say that they're not necessarily mutually exclusive. You might go that actually there's a really good, we already have an app and a camera makes a lot of sense within that. But that doesn't then rule out doing also some activations within WebAR that link those two, depending on what your job is. Is it about trying to get new users into your reward scheme or into your app infrastructure? You know, what are the metrics that you're measuring success by and are trying to achieve with the different activations? So I think it's just about, you know, strategically deciding what the right sort of choice is for you. I mean, clearly WebAR is something that is fast evolving, and I think lots of people are obviously keen to understand how they could do more in the browser, but I don't think it's, you know, I don't think that native apps should be ruled out entirely. Boy, you're on mute there, Martin.
Yeah, that old trick never grows old. Ed, before we move on, did you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, I totally agree with that. It's really about understanding the use case. I mean, the 7-Eleven was really a no-brainer, given that 7Rewards was such an established and powerful loyalty scheme, and AR could really work so well in conjunction with that. But that was one of the difficulties, honestly, Kings Hawaiian, is we were essentially creating this concept of flavor points, the loyalty and rewards in its own right, pretty much from scratch, and there's a learning curve to do that. So definitely needs to be thought about. Definitely the use case and the strength of the case for using WebAR has certainly increased with COVID and QR codes everywhere. Scanning behavior is now second nature to so many people. And again, the quality of what can be produced in a web setting versus an app, that gap has very much shrunk as well with the quality of the new devices and processes that have been coming out. So yeah, definitely kind of lead by the use case. And sorry, just one more point on sports teams as well. Fan apps, in my opinion, are having a bit of a second coming as well. They've always existed for most of the big teams, but with a lot of food and beverage ordering now happening through app within stadiums, there's another increased use case for consumers and fans to be spending time in those apps, and that's another good reason to really double down with AR.
Great. Thank you. We've got an interesting question come in, and it's all around our experience with integrating 3D and AR into the retailer's delivery service. So really using AR to amplify the unboxing experience. And I think this is a really interesting area that I think some of my partners are only really just beginning to explore. There's been a lot of work at physical retail, using AR to amplify the online listings and e-commerce. And now I think the tail end of the user journey in that respect is the home delivery. And that box then becomes, or the delivery docket then becomes that, I suppose that last piece of owned media that the brand can activate a comms activate as a comms channel. Mm. I think that's a really valuable piece of real estate that our partners are using to, I suppose, improve the unboxing experience, but also be able to then collect data and get people to register to the warranty and the warranty programs, which is probably bottom of the list that anybody wants to do when they've just had a new product through the door. So it is, from my side, I definitely see a growing interest there. That, I suppose, it ties into our passion for packaging as a brand's media channel that they've got total control over.
Yeah, I've always loved that example, and I'm pretty sure I stole this from Andre, but he was saying when you get a package delivered to your house, it's one of the only channels that has close to 100% open rate. I mean, whether that's you opening it or your package gets stolen off your doorstep, I mean, it's still going to get
someone's opening it.
Exactly. So I think that's really interesting, and I would almost, it's slightly different, but I would extend that to direct mailers as well. Just being able to place that Peloton bike in your house and kind of push the consumer down that funnel to purchase as well by actually seeing the product in their house. There's massive opportunities to do that with all of the, even just meal kits coming through your door, having the chef pop out and explain what's going on. I think they're really fascinating use cases.
Great. Okay, how are we doing for time? I think we are coming up to... last few minutes, so any more questions, then pop those into the channel.
That's quite a good one that's come in here, Martin. How is AR helping the customers while inside a retail store? What kind of solutions is Zappa providing for that?
Great. Well, I think I would definitely kick off with repeat that coffee analogy or that coffee story, where it is a real utility of how do we help the consumer fathom their way through all those different coffee machines to choose the right one for them. So it is product selection. And I think Nivea are another great example of that. They understand that they've created so many different, as we just see on the screen there, so many different variants of their sun cream range that I don't know which one to get. Do I go for a high number, a low number, or what's right for me or the kids? So they had an AR experience really as product education to help people navigate through the range and pick up the right product for them. Mm. So I think there's definitely a lot of utility and product education there.
Mm. For me, an interesting one is the at shelf tiebreaker. So you walk into a retail setting, you're presented with so much choice, even the toothpaste aisle, 50 different toothpastes you can choose from. Typically, where brands have tried to stand out is with familiarity of the brand name, packaging, texture, size of packet. What you have now with the QR code is you have an opportunity to engage at a different level, and you can influence that purchase there and then in store with a 10, 20, 30 seconds that you get to potentially deliver an AR experience. I think that is really fascinating, and we're going to see a lot more of that. And then, of course, for certain products that aren't just single use and you're throwing away the primary packaging, there's opportunities to re-engage as well. We talk a lot about breakfast cereals being a great use case in the CPG space. The breakfast cereal is going to sit on the breakfast table every morning. It's going to keep coming out. You keep having opportunities to re-engage. Mm-hmm. But for me, within that retail store setting, with QR codes so prevalent now and consumers very familiar with scanning behavior, what we're also starting to see is the QR code that lived on the back of the flap of frozen peas in the bottom of your freezer is now coming around to the front of the packaging. So you're seeing it as you look at the product on shelf. And I think that's very much kind of testament to how far this once forgotten QR code it has come, and with that the opportunity for AR as well.
I think the last one I'd mentioned on that was two points. One is, you know, I guess there are certain stores that have only a certain amount of product that they can actually have out. And also there's a cost to having those products as demonstrators. And so actually to be able to have then a way to show the rest of the range and the different types of color variants and, you know, sort of special editions, et cetera, through AR is then quite a compelling way for any salesperson. You know, some of it's assisted, some of it isn't, to be able to actually visualize those things and use it. I mean, the one cynic in me on retail is that you really have to think about your brand and your place in people's lives, and whether in a, you know, kind of busy shopping environment, whether you can really command someone's time to want to interact with you, depending on what level of interest it might be to them. And so I think for some of those kind of home care and homeware products, actually the benefit might be more in the at-home occasion than necessarily in-store occasion. And the other thing, you know, to be very conscious of retail is making sure you've got decent network and Wi-Fi connectivity there, because again, some of them are large metal boxes and therefore actually aren't necessarily that conducive to sort of spinning up your camera view and being able to interact with them. So there's definitely things that absolutely opportunities, but it's so important to think about putting yourself in that user's shoes and that moment of assistance. And is it right? You know, have they got a hand free? You know, is it the right thing to do? So definitely worth kind of properly considering what you're delivering at that moment. Martin, you're on mute again.
God, will I ever learn? There's been a lot of talk about physical retail, and I think one thing that's definitely happened globally over the last 12 to 18 months has been the exponential increase in e-commerce traffic. And I'm definitely seeing a lot of additional interest from my partners who want to amplify their marketing, so their traffic driving to the e-commerce platforms, but also elevate their product experience on those platforms themselves. So how do they make a product listing more immersive? And I think the timing is great, because we're seeing that in most cases, 80% plus of e-commerce traffic is now mobile driven. So web AR is a perfect solution for those mobile visitors to an e-commerce platform to tap on a link and launch an immersive experience. Whether it is the product visualization like we saw on that video roll where the golf club explodes so you can see inside. But there's a definite growth, I think, in the use of immersive experiences and AR within the e-commerce solution, both from, as I said earlier, the driving of traffic there, but making that decision-making process a lot quicker. And Ed, I loved your phrase. I'm going to steal it for myself. That tiebreaker situation. You know, how do we capture people's attention and get them to yes faster? Mm-hmm. And to Ed or Casper, do you have any thoughts or comments on the e-commerce side of things?
Only that, you know, the data is incredibly encouraging in terms of the work that not only we've done, but we're obviously seeing from others in the market in how it seems to reduce bounce rates, you know, increase conversion through that sales funnel, greater repeat usage and higher dwell times. You know, when we see dwell times in AR in excess of 90 seconds, and you compare that to other, digital media, it is quite something. And with bounce rates tending to be down at sort of 20%, again, they're pretty impressive. So we know that the level of attention and interest and engagement that AR provides has a positive impact. So it seems to make perfect sense to use it. You've got people already on their device, and you've got a way to either inform or inspire or incentivize people to be more likely to purchase or repurchase. So it seems like you're missing a trick, frankly, if you're not thinking about how you might leverage, you know, the camera for your brand and products.
Great, thanks, Casper. Ed, for a final word, anything to add to that, or should we generally just wrap up?
I think I'm good. I'd just be saying the same thing again. So,
so good, say it twice. Great. Well, I think that brings us to the end of the questions. So unless there are any last minute questions to post on the channel, then thank you very much.
Right, thank you so much, guys. Just a quick word from me before we depart. So we've got our next webinar coming up on the 5th of October. So that's a Tuesday again, we're regular. And that's gonna be a live learning session with Fran from our learning and support team. And we're gonna be covering our new multiple face tracking technology. So how you can build one and everything that goes into it. So it's gonna be an awesome session and not to be missed. That should be available to sign up on our website hopefully tomorrow, just waiting for that to go live. So yeah, that's a thank you from all of us, and we hope to see you again soon.
Thanks, everyone.
See you later.